Imagine, around 30,000 years ago, a frozen night during the Ice Age, the silence of snow-covered plains broken only by the crackle of fire. The scent of half-cooked meat lingers in the air, and smoke rises slowly into the night sky. Exhausted, mud-covered hunters sit around the flames, dressed in furs and skins, roasting the flesh of mammoth or deer over the fire. But beyond the circle of light, in the darkness at the edge of the forest, a shadow moves. Eyes glint silently, watching. A lone wolf. Large. Muscular. Hungry. And cautious. It steps closer. One of the hunters rises, the others stay silent. The wolf bares its teeth, lets out a low growl, but does not retreat. The hunter bends slowly and tosses a bone, still heavy with meat, into the dark. And that moment, that brief, quiet moment, has never left us. A moment that may have marked the beginning of something the world had never seen before. A creature we would one day call a dog. A relationship that thousands of years later would change the world forever. That night, something ancient began. But to understand what really happened by that fire, we need to look at the world that came before. A world ruled by a predator unlike any other. The prehistoric gray wolf. Fierce, fast, intelligent, a creature built for survival, with bone-crushing jaws and a nose that could detect humans from over a mile away. They hunted in packs, silent, strategic, and ruthless. No prey could outrun them. No territory was safe. And yet, how did it happen that the descendants of these wild beasts would one day curl up beside our fireplaces and wag their tails when we come home? How did one of the most dangerous predators become mankind's most loyal friend? In this video, we travel back into the mist of forgotten time to uncover how this extraordinary bond was born and how from within the shadow of the wolf, the dog emerged. Welcome to Secrets of the Unseen World. Tonight we follow the silent footsteps of the wolf to uncover how one of the fiercest predators became humanity's most loyal friend. But not all wolves belong to those deadly, organized packs. In the heart of frozen forests, there were wolves who lived alone, more solitary, more cautious, and far less inclined to fight. And it was these lone wolves who changed everything. Their solitude pushed them toward a new threshold, a fragile line between wildness and adaptation. Today, scientists believe it was these lone wolves who, instead of attacking, chose to stay. To observe, to come closer. Over time, the distance between them and humans grew smaller. Perhaps drawn by the scent of meat, perhaps curious about the strange, warm light that humans carried with them wherever they went. And the humans? They didn't respond with violence. Sometimes, they simply tossed a piece of meat a little farther away. And the wolf would cautiously approach, take the offering, and vanish. Back into the dark. That's where trust began. And from that moment, a path began. A path that would one day lead to the birth of the creature who now sleeps beside our beds at night. And if a sound is heard, will stand up at once to protect us. long before the first dog was ever born, and long before humans built their villages and civilizations, there were creatures ruling the earth. Creatures unmatched in strength, intelligence, and coordination. The ancient gray wolves. These were ruthless professional hunters, muscular bodies, long legs, thick tails, and massive heads. With jaws so powerful, they could crush dense bones with a bite force of 400 to 500 newtons. Their sense of smell, among the sharpest in the animal kingdom. They could detect the scent of prey, or humans, from over a mile away. And with piercing eyes and ever-alert ears, they became nearly invincible predators. But what truly set them apart was the way they hunted. Gray wolves hunted in highly coordinated packs. Each pack, usually 6 to 10 members, had a strict social structure, and every wolf had a defined role. Some chased the prey, others steered it toward ambush points, and some simply watched, waiting for the perfect moment to strike. This precise teamwork not only increased their chances of success, but kept the risks of injury at a minimum. But not all wolves belonged to such lethal packs. In the colder, quieter forests of the north, some wolves lived alone. Why? Some were outcasts, too old, too weak, or too different. Others simply preferred solitude. They hunted smaller animals, rabbits, birds, or scavenged remains. They didn't growl, they didn't charge. Unless they were certain, they stayed back. And unlike their aggressive kin, these solitary wolves did something different when they saw humans. They didn't attack, they paused, they watched. And that hesitation changed everything. Maybe they were just following the scent of meat. Maybe they were curious about this fire-carrying creature on two legs. But slowly, they came closer. From a distance, they simply watched. And it was these lone wolves who built the first fragile bridge between the world of animals and the world of humans. Some of those lone wolves would approach human camps at night, always keeping a safe distance. The fire, the scent of roasted meat, and the sound of human voices, all of it was unfamiliar and frightening, but strangely fascinating. Unlike the pack wolves, they had no intention of attacking. Not out of kindness, but out of caution. They were hungry, but they waited, hoping, perhaps, that a bone or a scrap of hide would be tossed into the darkness. And sometimes it was. Humans, always seeking to reduce threats and manage resources, noticed that these lone wolves, unlike others, didn't fight, didn't snarl, and were content to back away. So at times, just to get rid of them, they would throw a bone. But those simple bones were the earliest signs of a changing relationship. Over time, certain wolves began to approach more closely. They growled less, acted more calmly, and instead of fleeing, they began to stand still and simply watch. These wolves were smarter, more adaptable, and more peaceful, and likely carried genetic traits that made them better suited for coexistence. Today, scientists believe that this natural selection, in which calmer, less aggressive wolves were tolerated and even favored by humans, marked the beginning of what we now call the evolution from wolf to dog. It wasn't just a legend whispered around ancient fires. In recent decades, science began confirming what may have happened thousands of years ago between humans and wolves. In 1914, archaeologists in Germany made a curious discovery: human remains buried alongside the skeleton of an animal. But this creature wasn't quite a wolf, nor was it a modern dog. At first, there was doubt. But years later, with advances in DNA analysis, it became clear this was a dog. A dog that had been buried next to its human companion, More than 14,000 years ago, it remains one of the oldest and most touching pieces of evidence of the bond between humans and dogs. The skull was smaller than that of a wolf, the snout shorter, the teeth less suited for tearing flesh, and based on modern reconstructions, the brain showed signs of adaptation, changes linked to increased social behavior. This was no longer a wolf. It was one of the very first dogs in history, the product of thousands of years of natural selection and quiet cohabitation. And this wasn't the only case. In Siberia, China, the Middle East, and even parts of North America, similar remains have been found. Dogs buried near humans, sometimes even curled beside them. This suggests something remarkable, that the domestication of wolves may have happened not just once, but several times, in different regions of the world. Wherever humans and wolves met, and chose not to fear each other. The domestication of dogs wasn't a sudden event. It was the result of thousands of years of interaction, selection, and adaptation. The starting point. Those lone wolves that crept closer to the glow of fire on cold nights. They weren't just smarter. They carried genes that made them calmer, more tolerant of humans, and more socially responsive. Generation after generation, the calmer wolves were more likely to survive because humans didn't see them as a threat. This process is known as mutual natural selection. Humans tolerated the wolves that growled less or didn't attack boldly, and those wolves in turn found a safer environment, more chances to survive and reproduce. Over time, aggressive behavior in certain wolf lines faded. Faces became rounder, ears droopier, tails more curled. Even coat colors began to change. And most importantly, social, pack behavior began shifting into cooperative behavior with humans. Some researchers believe humans unknowingly favored pups that were gentler, more playful, and more responsive. This led, over a few hundred generations, to the emergence of something new, not a pure wolf, and not quite the dogs we know today, but something in between, a creature in transition. And here's the fascinating part. If you were to repeat this process today with another wild animal, the same pattern might unfold. In Russia, scientists bred foxes for friendliness. Only the most sociable pups were allowed to reproduce. And after just 40 generations, those foxes started behaving like dogs. In the same way, thousands of years ago, wolves who approached humans, not out of affection, but due to their genetic intelligence, gradually gave rise to the animal we now call the dog. It didn't happen overnight. It took thousands of years, thousands of fires, cautious glances, and silent throws of leftover bones. But in the end, one of them stayed, didn't walk away, maybe for the safety it found near humans, maybe for the warmth of the fire and the easy food, or maybe for a sense of belonging that quietly bound the wolf to us. That wolf was no longer just a wolf, and humans were no longer alone in the dark. From that moment on, their paths became one. They hunted together, walked together, and maybe even dreamed together. That fragile thread of trust turned into a bond so deep that even now, thousands of years later, it still lies beside us at night. Sometimes with closed eyes, and sometimes with a watchful gaze. As a loyal guardian and friend, who chose to walk with us through the shadows of history. And perhaps, just perhaps, it wasn't us who domesticated the wolf. Maybe it was he who chose us for friendship.